In this lecture, I'll be discussing about a distillation. As you know, in my previous videos, I have given a basic definition of distillation and the basic components of distillation, the flooding regarding that. In this video, I'll be discussing the basic definition and the basic data required for distillation and further the types of distillation methods. Coming to the definition, distillation is one of the techniques used for separation of components from a solution using thermal energy. Which depends on distribution of substances between liquid and gaseous phase. So this is a very basic definition. Later, after going through the types of distillations, I'll be giving you the exact definitions, which will be much more worth at the time. So by thermal energy, the separation of two volatile components is called distillation. And as you know, evaporation, absorption, and basically the difference between distillation, evaporation, and absorption I'll be discussing. In evaporation, the separation is between a non-volatile solute, non-volatile solute and volatile solvent. But in distillation, both the components are volatile. And coming to absorption, absorption is like a separation by introducing new substance, that is new solvent, with solution. Further separation takes place with the differences in the concentration. So this is the basic difference between a distillation, evaporation, and absorption. So coming back to distillation, here the limitations are more compared to absorption, because in absorption different solvent can be taken and can be used to improve the separation between the components. But in distillation, as we won't include any new substance, so the vapor which is formed from the solution is chemically similar with liquid. So sometimes there can be no change in composition between liquid and vapor phase, then the distillation becomes impractical, because if there is no difference in the concentration, there won't be any separation taking place. So the limitations are more in distillation compared to absorption. Now, to proceed with the problems in the distillation, we need basic data. So in distillation, the basic data is formed from the distribution of liquid and gaseous phase. To understand the liquid and gaseous phase, we need to know about vapor liquid equilibrium, VLE. Equilibrium, which means the condition attained when there is no tendency for a change in the process. No tendency for a change is vapor liquid equilibrium. And the degrees of freedom for this vapor liquid equilibrium is C minus P plus 2, the number of components and the number of phases plus 2. Let us take a binary solution. In binary solution, the number of components will be 2, and the number of phases are liquid and gaseous phase 2 plus 2. The total F will be 2. Degrees of freedom F represents 2, which means we need 2 parameters to find out the remaining things. In distillation, the parameters we use is temperature, pressure, and the liquid phase composition, vapor phase composition. So out of these 4, if you fix any 2 parameters, you can find out the remaining all parameters. So I'll be taking one parameter fixed. Let it can be temperature or it can be pressure. If I fix temperature, with the change in the pressure, I can find the liquid phase composition and vapor phase composition. Similarly, when I fix this pressure, I can find the liquid phase and vapor phase by change in the temperature. Let me take a constant pressure condition. In the constant pressure condition, I will take a still bath by providing a heater. This is maintained under constant pressure, that is the primary condition, and I'll be introducing a solution consisting of A and B. I'll be heating it 40 degrees centigrade initially, and I will get some vapor and liquid phase composition X and Y. Now I will increase the temperature to 50 degrees centigrade and keep it for some time to get an equilibrium. Here the equilibrium means no tendency for change. Further, if there is a no change in composition, then equilibrium is attained. At 50 degree, I will note further X2, Y2, liquid phase and vapor phase composition. Similarly, I will take for different temperature and note down this. From these, I will get a graph. So let us draw the graph. X-axis, I will consider composition of liquid and vapor of A. Let me take A as more volatile component and B as less volatile. So as A is more volatile, which means the boiling point of A is less compared to B. Let it be TA, the boiling point of A. And the boiling point of B will be TB, which is higher than A. And if I draw temperature and a composition of liquid phase, I'll be getting a graph like this. And similarly, if I draw between the temperature and the vapor phase composition, then I will get this graph. This is T versus X and this is T versus Y. Below this line, this is liquid phase and this is gaseous phase. I'm considering a binary solution. Now here, I'm taking the, as I told, I'm taking at 40 degrees. Let me consider this as 40 degrees centigrade. At this 40 degree centigrade, my solution composition be something here, which is completely at liquid state. And I will consider this as 0.1. Further, when I increase this temperature till the 0.2, that is the first bubble of vapor formation takes place at 0.2, and the composition of vapor at that point can be drawn by just taking a horizontal line, and this will be the composition. Let it be 2 dash. This is the composition of vapor I'll be getting and this point is the first bubble formation. That's why this is called a bubble point curve. Similarly, I'll further heat the solution and let me take a 0.3 here. At this point, if I consider this TY graph, this will be the composition of vapor. I will take it as 3 dash and extending this horizontal and further to this curve, this will be the 3 double dash, which is the composition of liquid phase of this component A. So here both liquid and vapor phase compositions are found. Further, when it is heated to the 0.4, this is the last drop of liquid found at this point, and this point the liquid vaporizes the last drop. So this one is called dew point curve. At this point, the composition of liquid can be found from this. Let this be 4 double dash. So this is how, this is the method used to find out the liquid and gaseous phase, vapor phase compositions. So here we have two things, bubble point and dew point. Let me repeat it. A bubble point is the formation of first bubble from the vapor, that is the initiation, and dew point is the last drop of liquid vaporizing. So here two temperatures are found, and there is no such term called boiling point. This is very important. There is no such term called boiling point in mixtures. If I take an individual component, a pure component, it has a boiling point. Suppose if I take water for 1 atmosphere, I can tell at 100 degrees the boiling point. But I can't tell for a mixture, this is a boiling point. I can mention it as a bubble point and a dew point temperatures from this curve. Similarly, now if I take constant temperature, then I will take the pressures as A is more volatile. The similar case I will consider A more volatile and B less volatile, and these are the compositions of A, and the y axis here will be the pressure, partial vapor pressure. As A is more volatile, the vapor pressure will be obviously more, and the vapor pressure of B. And if I take the data and draw, this will be P versus Y line, and this will be P versus X curve. And this will be the vapor and this will be the liquid. So similar analysis of taking a line from here, and if I further increase the pressure to till here, then I can draw the tie lines, which will give me, this will be the vapor phase composition and this will be the liquid phase composition. So from this curve I will take y and x composition curve. It's very easy to extract. Let's take a line and take a 45 degrees line exactly reflecting to this curve. I have considered this point where this will be my composition of liquid. So taking it down, this will be the composition of liquid, and the vapor composition is given here. This is the vapor composition. I'll be reflecting, this is vapor composition and this is liquid phase composition. So this is my point. So the point of intersection, this point and this point, I will get this point. Similarly, if I draw further more, I will be getting a lot of points like this. So this will be the profile for vapor phase composition and liquid phase composition. Further, I have taken this condition for constant pressure. And if I take the same curve for increase in some pressure, this let it be pressure P1, I am increasing the pressure to P2, then the curve again will be like this. And similarly, if I draw the same, I'll be getting a common point, this one. So which means, like this and another, this is a pressure P2 and this is a pressure P1. I'll be drawing very neatly here. Let me take this one as at pressure P1 and this will be at pressure P2. This is the diagonal line at 45 degrees centigrade. So with increase in pressure, the line is coming more closer to this equilibrium, this diagonal line, which means once it comes to diagonal line, y will be equal to x. When y is equal to x, when there is no change in the composition, when there is no difference in the composition, then there won't be any separation, then distillation won't be possible. So when we increase the pressure, it is coming more to the 45 degrees line. So at low pressures, the difference is observed more. That's why distillation is more preferred at low pressures. So these are some of the basic things we need to know before going to the problems. Let me take a basic overview. When we give some thermal energy, the separation starts by distribution of liquid and gaseous phase and both the components to be volatile. Then the data can be taken from this vapor liquid equilibrium using these charts, and from here we can extract this one. Between Y and X, we can take the line which we can further proceed for the problems. So low pressure distillation is preferred at low pressures. Now coming to this Raoult's law, for an ideal solution, as you know, for an ideal solution, the partial pressure is equal to the product of vapor pressure and the liquid phase composition. And Dalton's law, total pressure is equal to sum of the partial pressures. Let me take a binary component. These all things why I am explaining is required for the distillation before going through this number of stages and further finding these liquid phase vapor phase compositions. And from these, PA, the partial pressure, is equal to the product of vapor phase composition and total pressure. These three we know as we studied in thermodynamics regarding this, and I'll be introducing some new term that is called relative volatility. This is very important term you'll be continuously using in distillation. Volatility just gives the measurement how much it can be separated by distillation. Let me consider it as alpha for binary distillation. alpha AB is equal to relative volatility is the ratio of more volatile vapor pressure by less volatile vapor pressure, which means the relative volatility should always be greater than 1. As the partial pressure, the vapor pressure of A is always greater than vapor pressure of B. If both the vapor pressures are equal, when that is alpha AB is equal to 1, distillation is not possible. Because when there is no change in the vapor pressures or the boiling points, how can it, the components can be separated? And from this, we'll further derive relative volatility in terms of liquid phase and vapor phase compositions. So for this, the equation 1 and equation 2, if I'm taking it, then PAV XA is equal to YAP, where XA is the composition of A at liquid phase and YA composition of A at vapor phase. These are the terminologies I am using and further also. So note it here only, vapor phase and liquid phase, XA and YA. This is the vapor pressure of A and this is the total pressure. From here, the vapor pressure of A will be YA by XA into P. Let this be given into this alpha AB. Alpha AB is equal to YA by XA into P by YB by XB into P. Total pressure gets cancelled here. From here, YA by XA by YB is 1 minus YA divided by 1 minus YXA. That is alpha AB. Further, it can be written as YA into 1 minus XA by XA into 1 minus YA alpha AB. So here completely mathematical part will be there. If you want to skip, you can skip and take the direct relative volatility term. I will be anyway doing the complete mathematical part. Yeah, let's take YA minus YA XA alpha AB XA minus alpha AB XA YA. From here, let alpha AB XA is equal to, let me take YA common, which will be 1 minus XA plus XA alpha AB. So YA will be XA by XA alpha AB by 1 plus alpha AB minus 1 into XA. So this is the final definition. YA will be XA alpha AB by 1 plus alpha minus 1 into XA. And alpha AB is PAV by PBV. Just remember these two things, which will be used in the first step in every problem. Now next, I'll be discussing the methods of distillation. methods of distillation. So covering in short, there are three types of distillation. The first type is simple distillation, or it can be called as differential distillation, or relics, as it was given by Rayleigh. So relic distillation or batch distillation without reflex. You can term it as any way, and it can be asked any way. And the second method used is flash distillation, or it can be called as equilibrium distillation. And the third method for distillation is fractionation. Here in these methods, these two are simple, and the third method is a bit complex, but this is the common type of distillation used in industries. So in my next video, I will be taking each and every method in detail: simple distillation, flash distillation, and fractionation. If you like my video, subscribe to my channel to get more updates from my channel.